Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome in Mightiest Corner, the one and only Ted, the Elf Wilson. How are we doing, pal?
Good, mate. You? Yeah.
Absolutely fantastic. All the better for getting you on. It's been a while.
I keep in the shadows.
Yeah, I noticed that. You're always there lurking, but you're still competing. You're still getting a vote. But before before we move off into that, Ted, we're going to have a little bit of a background check on you. I'm not going to dig too far back, but I like in Mighty's Corner just to, you know, see where the elf grew up. And it was a little place called Urton in Cumbria.
Yeah, all right. There's not much around here.
Well, I remember because we come up to a tournament one year that you were putting on, and it took about 3 hours to get there down a country lane.
Yeah. And I remember Steve Rogers setting off with Austin going back home, and I think they did 3 left-hand turns, and they ended up back at the pub. Wait till everyone was.
Them and names from the past, didn't they? Austin Clark and Steve Rogers.
Yeah, good old days, them. Yeah, I miss those days.
Yeah, two legends. You brought up, you're now living in the bungalow that your dad built when he was 2 years when you was 2 years old.
Yeah, he built this. When he was back farming, and yeah, wanted somewhere, so we just built on the land, and it's still up.
Is it your granddad's land, that, Ted?
Yeah, my granddad's gone now, it's all on our own land. So we've got about 25-30 acres that just surrounds the bungalow. That's all ours. We've got Muncaster Fell right next to us. The little railway that goes up about, I don't know, 400 yards down. It's just nice and peaceful, out the way. Yeah.
Perfect place to grow up as a kid then, but you had a lot of fun there, didn't you?
Oh, aye. Yeah, well, my kids are doing the same now. When they come up, you can just let them roam and let them go. And I spent all my childhood just down the woods and, you know, throwing stones in the river. Not on bloody iPads and stuff like youngsters now.
Oh, it's terrible, isn't it? Oh, guys, I know. I'm having the same trouble myself. I've got 3 of them downstairs. You know, 2 iPads apiece, and then one of them's got one of them gaming computers.
Oof. Yeah, it's how the world's changing, isn't it, unfortunately?
Well, the world certainly changed in 2004 when the elf made his appearance. Tell me a little bit about how all that started.
Oh, now we're digging back. I think I've always been interested in, been at school and arm wrestling everyone, but I never did anything else. Never did any other sports. I was bloody crap at everything. But I thought there must have been something out there. So my girlfriend at the time did a bit of searching on the internet, got hold of Neil Pickup, and then it took a while I didn't even end up contacting Neil. It was I think it was Farmers Guardian sponsored event.
Nicole's? Oh, that weren't Nicole's one, was it? That were Young Farmers, weren't it?
Oh, no. Nick did a lot with Young Farmers, didn't he? I'd always went to the Royal Show, big agricultural show, always went with my mum and dad as kids, always stopped in caravan, always went. And at the time, I was living down near Bognor Regis, working on a big arable farm down there. And so we would go up to this Royal Show for a couple of days, meet my mum and dad there, had a good wander around. And right next to JCB stand, there was Farmers Guardian sponsored event. I don't know what it was. I don't know whether you were pulling there. I can't honestly remember. It was there.
I did a lot of the old Farmers Guardian stuff on that them years, yeah.
I went and seen them there and got on the table, and it was probably another 12 months till I got back in touch with someone, and then went to an event at Milton Keynes.
Yeah, I was just going to say that, because you at the time, you were seeing a girl with blonde hair, weren't you?
Yeah, I was.
Yeah, with a little bob. And it was a thing you weren't, she, did she work down there or something?
She moved down country with me when I got the job as...
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Christ, it seems like a hell of a long time ago, but yeah.
I remember, you know what, it's funny enough this, because I remember this like it was yesterday, because Neil put something on his Fix show. Have you seen that, this show, The Fix?
The which one?
It's called The Fix. It's with... The Fix. Yeah, with that Latvian and Ryan Bowen. What's his name? Coach Ray. Coach Ray, who couldn't hook a fish. And then you've got Ryan Bowen, who doesn't know whether he's Arthur or Martha, because, you know, he's trying everybody else's training apart from his own.
And yeah.
Of course, you've got Fat Pickup. But anyway, he was saying on this small show, and he was talking about our loose men's show, he said, on that small show, Paul Maiden, he was saying that I got beat off someone I never got beat off, Alex Zupko. And I thought, he did, because he got beat up left guard by Alex Zupko. He tried forcing up, and Alex Zupko beat me same day. And that's the first time I ever saw you roll there. Steve Curlew, Jason Brooks, we was all over in that big room.
Alex Zupko was a beast. It's strange. Like, I've never heard anyone mention that name for a long, long time. Blooming heck, guys. Was it Clive? Clive was an animal.
Clive
Ferguson, yeah.
Was a beast is then, because there was Arthur Dorov, do you remember him?
Arthur Dorov, yeah. All strong lads, yeah.
Then were the days, so that's when you come in. So you was at that tournament, 2004, Milton Keynes, and how did you get on?
I can't remember if I got second or I won that event. It was just a first novice event. And then I started training with Stephen Curlew and Matt Preston after that. And I travelled all over the place, just get as much experience as possible. That's where it all started, really. Yeah.
See, I remember like you being, because you, for your body size at that time, because you was really light then. Just stick your hand up, Ted, see if we can see how big it is in front of the screen. For like a little, for a tall guy, it's a gigantic hand, and you've been able to like apply hooks and top rolls to people you shouldn't have been doing it to. I mean, we're going to speak about some of your matches that you've had, incredible matches that you've had, you know, going on through your career and stuff. But you're one of a few guys that are from like the old guard. And I always mention you in interviews when I say there's very few of the old guard technicians left. You know, yourself, me, Neil. We just lost you at all retirement. And, you know, another one that's obviously Andy Barker left. So they're all guys. So there's only really a few of us left fighting. And obviously Tom Holland's up there as well. Technically great guy. But do you think nowadays, though, Ted, that we've lost a little bit of that technical prowess and guys are going more towards the power scene?
Oh, definitely. Like arm wrestling does change through times. It progresses, it evolves. But I think, like, back in the day, there was a point of, you know, you learn real. You go into great. I'm getting mixed up now. But basically, there was top roll. And then there was a flop wrist. If you could flop wrist someone, then you've got that match. And there's just, it's like throwing the cat among the pigeons, isn't it? It's just gone. It doesn't matter where a match goes now. And I think it's gone more into more power and just, rather than beating someone on pure technique over power. You're just getting incredibly strong guys coming through now. We'll just pull anywhere, and they don't care where they pull. You just have to look at Froda for that. There's a lot has changed, but I do still believe there's a massive amount of technical ability in there. But grassroots, I think it has lost its technical ability. There's everyone's focusing more on getting strong rather than learning the movements and learning the you know, mind and muscle connection, angles and things like that.
It's something I'm teaching down at Torture that, I think sometimes it might frustrate them that, you know, we just don't get on with the power thing. But I try and graft them all into good technicians, understanding the angles, understanding where your placement to feel the match instead of just trying to grunt it through. And I think that when you can do that, as you know, and you can feel the match, you can pretty much close your eyes and you know where a match is, where it's going
to go.
But also, you're right, we have got some mega people coming through. Strength-wise, my only worry is that there's a million and one strength guys, but there's only a few super technicians. And if you can sort of just, you know, find that happy balance in between, that's when you become special. And
Absolutely.
2006, Ted, I saw you killing yourself to try and be special. World Championships, Manchester Trafford Centre. Tell us a bit about that experience. You and Barry Knowles, 55 key.
If I can remember, that's feels that long ago. My memory goes anyways, but yeah, that was good because I did a lot of running about with Neil as well for that event, helping him try and organise it, and it was just a bit manic. But looking back, I felt strong at that weight. You know, 55, 60 kilo, I think if I just had a bit more time and stayed lighter, I would have maybe got a few more, you know, titles or something under my belt. All the way through my career, I was always obsessed with, I need to get a bit bigger, I need to get stronger, I need to get a bit bigger. But rather than just working with what I've got and staying light and being pound for pound better. I had some good matches in Manchester. Left arm, I remember a good match. I can't even remember what I actually ranked, what I ended up with. But that was some good times.
Yeah, all I remember is obviously Baz was one of my main teammates at the time. And you two were like, obviously, the two guys what could represent the country. And you're both just there outside waves like that. I remember saying to Barry, are you okay? Are you okay? Like, because the first time he'd ever crippled himself down to 55. I'm all right. And you're like that with it as well. But it's funny the things that we do in it just for make a weight, just for the arm wrestling.
For arm wrestling, yeah.
I mean... It's funny that you touch on that really about going bigger and bigger, because we'll get to that, because I know that you wanted to get bigger and bigger, and you did get bigger. You worked very hard at that, but the majority of your best arm wrestling, for me, has always been down at a lighter weight. That's where I've always seen you being, you know, at that world-class level, you know, that you was, and that you were at. I mean, because you're still genuinely at a world-class level, it's just you've not been on the circuit so much previously for the last, you know, year or two, you know, throughout the full year. But I remember...
Just losing you a bit there.
One second, can you hear me now?
He's trying to catch up with it. Yeah, hello. Yeah.
Hello, we all good?
I hope so.
Yeah. Well, it seems okay to me. Are we okay, though?
Right, yeah, that's all right. Crack on. I can hear you at least.
Well, guys, if it is a little bit to a flux around, well, I hope you're enjoying it. And if you've already, or if you've not done already, just like and subscribe and tinkle that bell. And Ted, it's a good time to plug your YouTube channel, pal. Doing a great job with that. I've watched all your stuff. Just plug it.
So I call it Arm Wrestling Extra. It's under Ted the Elf Wilson, and I basically cover bits of all sorts. I have Athlete Inside, which is just, you know, I get two guys, and they could be anywhere from the UK, America, Europe, just to try and get a bit more insight on their day-to-day lives and what makes them tick. But aside from that, I'm basically just trying to get a bit more info out there. Trying to help the guys getting in the sport with technique, just pointers, help, ideas on training, just any way I can help, I'm going to try and help the up and coming guys through my channel. Yeah.
And you're doing a good job, pal. Keep it going. More the merrier, I say.
Well, thank you.
Right. 2009 Sweden? You had a bronze medal dangling on your neck. European Championships, was it? What year was that?
2007.
Oh, that's right. Because we got some Zloty stories to tell as well. Because you was stopping over in the same room, weren't you? Oh.
2007 was a good year. I got most of my best wins in 2007. That was the year Dean Scarsbrook came on the scene as well.
Yeah.
That's pound for pound. That's probably one of the strongest UK pullers I've ever seen. Just immense. First seen him at New Year Cup 2007. That's where that year set off. And there was everybody in there. There was Steve Rogers, Ian Stones. Dean was in there. I think there was 13 or 14 guys in the class, and I never lost a pin all day. And I kind of kept that momentum all the way through 2007. Felt really good. That was a good year. Yeah. But I lost a lot of weight for Sweden, Europeans. That was like 3 days of not eating, drinking, saunering. That was brutal. That was the hardest ever. That was hard. But I was never going to pull 65s. We came to the scales and it was like first or second chance. But if you don't make this, don't worry, pull 65s, Neil was saying. I'm like, no, I'm not come this far, pull 65s. I'm pulling 60s. And I made it. I made the weight, bang on 60. And I just spent 2 days fueling up. And I felt strong. There was some tough guys in that event. Good times.
Yeah, it was a good time, mate. You're bringing back them medals then with Great Britain, and that's all that matters. You touch on that year. You also rolled into the Zloty. I were there, Baz were there, you were there. I think that was the first year that Barry beat Steve Rogers, weren't it? Steve Rogers pulled his arse cheek muscle in a nook. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I can vaguely remember that. Yeah.
Yeah, it's the only time I've ever seen a man inside. And I remember Steve and Baz. And Baz, I don't think Baz had ever beaten him, ever had he, at this point. They've been battling for years and years. And Steve, obviously, a lot of people won't know the name Steve Rogers. Let me tell you, Captain Scarlett was world champion in Canada 2003, left-arm world champion, WAF champion. He was an absolute animal.
Absolute freak. Absolute freak.
He's like...
guy on the armrest table.
And anybody thinking you're too old to start arm wrestling, he was 32 when he started. He was world champion at 40. So, and now he's best part of 60. So there you go. And he had a glittering career up to about 10 years ago.
And he'd probably still walk on the stage and give most of the 70 guys a run for the money.
It was an unbelievable condition. I mean, like, how he used to make weight, you're like looking at him, you think he must have balsa wood bones. He had 17-inch biceps, at 65 kilo, 10 stone, 4 pound.
I was just going to say that, like the biggest arms on the smallest dude. Oh, incredible.
Did you get any wins on him, Ted?
A few here and there, but nothing crazy. It wasn't like... there was never a win, and then it followed by another win of him. He always came back stronger. Tough guy. The only times I ever really got him was when my head was really on the game of the setups, and I made him uncomfortable. That's the only time. But he's the only guy that I've known that when you grip up with him, you just your ass starts nipping because he's so dominant. He just will not move. For both refs or anything, he will not move.
Yeah, he never lost a warm-up match, did he? Like, even when you were warming up in a figure of eight, he had to pin you every time, didn't he?
I've never seen him do a figure of eight. Never in my life. Just grip up and pin you. You're warm, yeah?
This guy, he was that good. They used to have to stick him against middleweights and heavyweights in challenge matches, didn't they? So... He was an animal. Anyway, he pulled his ass cheek in Zloty to finish the story. Him and Barry Dole, they are wrestling, and his arse cheek popped. So there you go. So 2007, Ted, do you remember what you finished?
Finished fourth on my left. Not too sure what I did on my right, but fourth, I had a good day. Yeah.
That was a good year. Were you British champion that year as well?
No, I was never British champion until 2009. So I got fourth in Zloty, and I got bronze at Europeans, but I still wasn't British champion.
The thing is, though, that shows how competitive it was back in the day, doesn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
And where the level is. Because I know people get fed up to the back teeth of me saying that the level, you know, is obviously thinned out throughout the years. You know that yourself. But back in the day, it was major. You know, we was a major world-class country, weren't we? We had strength in depth as well.
Yeah. Oh, there was loads of top-quality lads. Like, yeah, yeah, really good stuff. But, yeah, it has watered itself down a little bit. And, yeah, shouldn't say that. But it has. It just has.
You know, Ted, when you're going to a table nowadays, do you still get the same buzz pulling these newer guys than you did back in the day? Have you still got the same hunger?
I have and I haven't. It's difficult. It comes in waves, and probably that's why I've fluctuated up and down all the time. I'll come in and then I'll go out again. I don't get the same hunger and feel and feelings that I do originally, but I still do get that feeling of it. But it only comes in as soon as you get to that table. Do you know what I mean? And all depends on the opponent. Do you know what I mean? When I pull the British guys now, I don't have the same hunger. But when I went to Germany last year, that's the time when it really ignited it again. Because I pulled like the 80 kilo class over there. I hadn't trained for nearly 12 months. And I was swallowing my tongue. I so nervous. It was unbelievable. I've never been that nervous for years. And to get on and actually have some good matches, lit everything up again. Like hungry for it, you know.
Yeah, well, you just ruined that where I was going to go later, but it doesn't matter. We may as well touch on the October last year, that word at 2019 Germany.
Yeah, yeah.
I seen you having a good old pull with your old pal Philip Stelhoffen.
Yeah, that lad's strong. Always is. Bit of an animal.
You touched on that, he was 80 kilo. You've yo-yoed of late with your weight. Like you say, you've been down as low as 55, you've been as high as 85. The old cat's coming and just having to touch his bum up. you've had some, in between them weights, you've chased. How many British titles have you won in that? Because you've had some big wins as well, haven't you? Like Tom Holland as well, you beat Tom.
Yeah, yeah. 17-time British champion now. That's through 65, 70, 75 and 80. Because I got
four different weights.
Four different weights, yeah. 65 I've probably won, I don't know, 5 or 6 times. 70 two or three. I lose count, but yeah. But I won the 80s last year, but I certainly don't think I'm going any higher. Can't compete with those lads.
What are you weighing at now?
About 74, 75. And not in the best condition either. I reckon I can get, if I get enough motivation in me and get going again, I could quite happily get to 72 and keep my power going up, I reckon. That's what I'm thinking. That's my aim for by the end of the year. Be back down closer to the 70 kilo.
And is that where you see yourself sitting then from now on, around about 70? Like,
yeah, I'll drop to pull 70s more or less all the time now, I think. That's a good weight for me.
And through all them kids coming through, who do you see as the main threat?
What, in this country?
Yeah, for this country, yeah.
Man. See, someone who always shocks me was that, is it Ben White? I didn't really hear of him, and then I seen him at the British, I can't remember what year it was, and he'd like come out from nowhere. Where the hell's he been? He can't half pull that loud bugger, like, really can. But again, depends how motivated he is. You see a lot of these guys that they've got so much potential and as strong as they are, but it's how far they can push it, how far they want to push it. I've found that sometimes it's the ones that you don't notice. All of a sudden, another couple of years' time, you're like, bloody hell, where did he come from? You know, they push their level themselves, you know. I don't know. Like you said, there's a lot of guys. The classes are getting bigger all the time again.
This doesn't get a bit more exciting to me, for. I mean, I'm excited by Urban. I like Urban, me. He's got a bit of seller. He can sell a match well. He's a good-looking guy, fast, aggressive, ambitious, has great belief in himself. I like him. But then, you know, you've got quieter guys like the postman, Tommy Mitchell, who's been solid. You've got Sweet Shop Dave Savory, who, you know, dropped to 65s. I mean, and he's an 85 guy normally. And he dropped down there and won his left-hand British title, 65. Obviously, my old pal and your old mate there, Barry Knowles, still working around after all these years.
Yeah,
you know,
still going.
Alexander Meerkat, he's coming through. We've not seen Anil for a while, but he's going to be fierce, isn't he, Anil?
Where did I pull him at? Pulled him on a practice table somewhere, and he felt fierce. He really did. It was maybe Farm Wars. I had a little play with him on the table, and he felt strong. So, yeah, it's the guys like that that you're not really hearing of the training or out like that, but they're obviously out there training. He'll come back, come strong, yeah.
Do you see yourself being a level above all these guys, though, Ted?
Personally, deep down, anybody can beat me. I'm only human, and people have beaten me. I'm not, you know. One thing I struggle with is confidence in myself. I know when I've been on form, I can beat some of the top guys, and when I'm not, anybody can beat me. I'm just, you know. But yeah, these guys, we're all right there. We're all at the same level. Like Connor Sale. Connor Sale's coming up. That's one fierce hitter. That's like I was saying about positions before. He doesn't care where he goes on the table, and he'll get strong if he stays injury free. You know, in the next 4 or 5 years, he'll be a bad man. Do you know what I mean? We're all up there. Just depends how. I think mentality is a huge part. Do you know what I mean? A lot of these guys, our British lads, can go out abroad and pull, and they'll probably surprise themselves how hard they can pull. I found out early when I first started, that's one thing. All I wanted to do was go and feel, see how strong these top guys were, and that gave me a level of where I need to be, how hard I need to train. There's no point in going into it and picking and choosing tournaments and believing you're great but not pulling the greats. You've got to go out there. Yeah. You've got to compete.
And that touches back into something that we were scraping on earlier when you said that when you went to Germany, that reignited the fire, the buzz. Now, I've had this conversation with other people, with Neil, with Craig, etc. And I even spoke about it to many people within PAA and stuff. And I was always saying that I always feel better when I'm going abroad. It's my ambition lies away from UK now. That's no disrespect to UK. Like yourself, I can still be beaten. No. I can still be beaten, and I have been beaten. But, you know, people have said to me, oh, well, you trained day before, you trained that morning at competition, you still come. Because I just want to support arm wrestling. But
Yeah.
When, last year, when I wanted to peak for tournaments, I wanted to peak in January. I won. I went to China. I peaked in China. I won. I was once at Worlds, and obviously this happened. You know yourself, Ted. You want to be strong for everything, but you, when you get a bit older and you've got that wear and tear, you've got to pick and choose where you want to be peaking. But I don't want to miss an event, so I'm not arsed. I mean, I'm past that stage, me, of having that, you know, measuring cocks with people. You get beat, you get beat, and that's just part and parcel of the game. But my buzz lies abroad. You know, like I've done everything at UK. You can win. I've won every title, the same as yourself and many others.
I do. I feel the same. I feel like if you plan to go to a tournament abroad, it's like turning the switch on. You know, you've got to get however long you've been in the sport or you haven't trained or you have trained, that arm wrestling switch is turned on and it's until you get there, it all, you know, the traveling there, the getting there, preparing for the event, it's like you're a different person. You are. You're just so highly more focused on that event. It's just a total different buzz, isn't it, than just
Do you find, Ted, though, when you go abroad, how can I put it, because you're not necessarily friends on social media and seeing these guys on a regular occurrence, do you feel like it doesn't matter if you just put your headphones on and you storm up and down the room like a caged tiger than when you're back at home training or when you're going to crafters and you know you speak to 50 people on Facebook and they come over, how's your wife, how's your mum, what you're doing, and you feel like you have to speak to that person. Do you feel that takes the edge off?
Probably a little bit, because it's just so, it's like a second home, isn't it? You know, it's like like you say, everyone's around you, it's just so more, all the level, the atmosphere, the feelings, everything's like sunken down, just chilled out a bit more. Whereas, like say, you go abroad, you're looking at your competitions that you've never ever pulled before, and it's like going to war. Do you know what I mean? Totally different spike of adrenaline.
I have that complete theory in my head, like that same thing. And people said to me like, you seem a different person when you're abroad. Well, I am. Because when I'm here at home, you feel like, you know, you make friends, don't you? And I always said to my guys, listen, I'm sort of past it a little bit now, obviously a bit long in tooth with it all, but when I psych myself up, when I'm sat there and I've done my meditation in the morning and my naked stretches, as you very well know, I've done them all in every hotel in the world. And when, you know, but when I've done that and I'm right and I walk through that front door, I'm in a mindset of I'm seeking and destroying. Now, when I'm abroad, and I'm a person that needs to be in that like mode. I was same at school, like when one of the bullies said to me, I'm going to knock your teeth out. And I was shitting myself all day before the fight. But I was psyching myself up all day. But when it came, I was ready. But all day leading up to it, I was like fucking butterflies and you know what I mean? And I'm saying when it comes to me, arm wrestling. So... When I'm driving to Crofters, like if I'm going, I've got all butterflies and I'm thinking, oh. But as soon as I get out of the car and Craig Saunders comes over, gives me a kiss, and then you see all your friends, how are you doing? Hey? And I sort of move out of that mindset. I think we are all at the same boat sort of thing. I never used to allow that to happen. And that's why people like me, but we never had social media then, did we? You know, so there were none of that friendships made. Whereas when you're abroad, like you know people, but you give them a nod, but you're never taken out of that zone. And then you know, I had obviously the best two competitions of my life, getting that world silver and bronze. But
that's the buzz. You know, like I feel like I want to travel abroad more. I want to compete abroad again. I want
to
test.
Talking to you. I want to go now, just talking to you again.
Honestly, it's like, it's like that, just reborn again. Do you know what I mean? I feel like I'm starting my arm wrestling career again, and I just want to, like when I first started, I went abroad maybe 3 or 4 times a year to compete, just to try and get better, and I loved it. That was my life. nothing else mattered. I feel like I'd love to do that again, but, you know, family and kids and work and everything else, it gets in the way. But if I can aim to just try and keep motivation and a bit of fire and, yeah, train hard again and focus on maybe one trip away a year, then that'll suit me. Do you know what I mean? As long as I can progress, that's all I want to do again now. I just want to progress, get to that next level.
It's that positivity thing, though, Ted, isn't it? I think that, like, at the moment, you know, the UK and Ireland scene's absolutely buzzing. Everyone's got a buzz on, from the novices to the intermediates to the professional. Everyone seems to have got that positivity, that vibe. There's only a couple of negative shows. But, you know, when you're in that position where, you know, you're surrounding yourself around people with similar mentalities to yourself, you know, that positivity, it just grows. It's just growing. And then you start attracting more people. And then you attract more people with the same like-minded positivity. And before you know it, you're just erupting. And I think that's what's happening now. We've got a resurgence in UK. And I'm buzzing for it.
Buzzing. Yeah.
I mean, it must be because it brought you back. So, you know, last time I saw you, we was working at Inley. We were drunk and you had an handbag in your hand. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I can't remember that.
You spent more time with my missus than I do.
Eh?
You spent more time with my missus than I do.
Anyways.
No, but you know what? You've had a life, and we may as well touch on a bit of it, Ted, because within the arm wrestling world, everybody knows you. I mean, you've spent time with Devin Larratt, Kevin Berg, you've been everywhere. What would you say is your most favourable moment ever in arm wrestling?
Jesus. Now you're touching on stuff. Bloody hell. Can I get back to you?
Well, you know,
so many, like some of the stories, like, but
well, just give us a couple. Just give us a couple of your most favourite. You don't have to be one. Give us a couple. You've had an illustrious career.
Well, probably me favourite moment is like I say, going back to 2007, getting that bronze. I'll tell you a little bit. Basically, I broke skinned, absolutely no money, mind you, still am. But I remember being in I think it was left arm. Was it left arm first? Well, anyways, at the night time, stood in hotel. Neil's getting some drinks in. I said, I'm going to ring me dad.
Hang on, sorry, Ted. Say that again, because I don't believe what I just heard.
So, anyways, so I went to ring my dad, and I rung my father, and I'm speaking with him, and he knew how hard I was training. When I was training for Europeans and Worlds, my routines were ridiculous. I was getting up at 5 in the morning, running, you know, 3 jackets on. I was taking punch bags up over the fell, you know, on my shoulder, like 30, 40 sets of wrist curls a day, and then going to work. It was manic. And I rung my dad, and I'm speaking with him. And he's like, look, you haven't gone all that way for nothing. Just give it everything you've got tomorrow. And just, yeah, it was one of them moments where it was like, doesn't matter if I lose, but I'm putting everything into this. I was that focused. I didn't even know on the day when I was competing that I was going up for a match for the final. I was just totally in the zone. And Neil was shouting us when I was going on. And I pulled Robert Chomiev for the final. I didn't even know I got third. I was that much in. He was 55 or 60 kilo world champ at the time. I think he I bet he's been world champion about six times or something crazy. He was an absolute animal. But yeah, I took his hand and raced. I was just on fire. I was just so focused on that day. Yeah, came back with bronze. And it was amazing out there. Like, there was a club right next to the hotel, and it was like, well, it was right at the top of Sweden, so it was sunshine 24/7. Coming out of the club at 3 o'clock in the morning, and you're getting a suntan. Do you know what I mean? It's just weird. Such a weird.
Yeah, I remember Engin Terzi. Engin Terzi whinged about that once. Well, it whinged about it. He said it was a bit of an issue, because anyone who doesn't know, it's literally sunny for 6 months a year, all year round, because of the position where it is. So he was struggling to sleep because your body doesn't know whether it's day or night.
Yeah, yeah. We were just getting that drunk. After I got that bronze, we were just getting that drunk and then sleeping in till after dinner anyways. So, and then going out straight drinking again. It was awesome. That's an awesome memory. I loved that. Yeah, like, went to South Africa 2004. That was a crazy experience. I bet you've got a few stories from over there as well.
Yeah, nothing I can mention on this camera, I'll tell you. yeah, quite a few. One of the best ones though was poisoning Barry. Me and Barry, we'd just been out on my birthday. Not actually, that was with Stuart Hall actually, because I poisoned Baz the day before. And Baz at hotel, he says, "Oh, do us a favour, Paul, just pour us some water." So me just thinking, I just went in the bathroom and give him some tap water. He got a drink. Obviously, he thought it was out of bottled water. And morning after, I'm hallucinating, shitting through iron needle, throwing up everything. That was but we'll leave that one there. There was a lot going on there, though, let me tell you. But you know what? I was actually wondering that, because I didn't know you'd gone there. But I remember we took a team of about 27, 28 guys, didn't we? There were you, Danny Axworthy, people might not have seen. He's made a resurgence again. He was there. Barry was there. Neil, Andy Burke, Stuart Hall, Alan Greaves. You know, these are names that majority of people know. We had a big team, didn't we, Ted?
Yeah, it was huge. It was huge. And then it started
the decline a little bit then, weren't it?
Yeah. Well, that was like my first year at arm wrestling. So I started in the February, and it was straight away like, when's Worlds? I want to compete. And it was just, it set off a craze. Yeah.
Well, I remember we was just absolutely traveling everywhere. We had them with some like busy years, weren't they? Everything were going on. You wouldn't have been there. You were there that year. That was 2003 when Steve Rogers won that quad bike, were you?
No, I wasn't there. No.
Well, that was year before you started, I think. That was doing all the start of all the firm shows, all the Farmers Gary and stuff. The year before, that was pretty cool. I think we did some like, I think I worked out, I did 18 tournaments in a year. That was including Worlds, Europeans, Isle of Man. That TT races, man. Booed. All day we got booed. I'm like, we've got a lot of novices, Ted. We've got a lot of novices going to be watching. Give us your best tips for them novices. Give us one good piece of advice that they should be following.
Right. Number one is basically, well, obviously, if you're in a club, that's fine. Find something. You could split this down into so many different ways, but just pick one thing, just a one trick move. I was always a top roll, and it was ages till I actually progressed to learning the hook. I think for a start, just enjoy it and just find something that you're good at and make sure it's safe, and everything else will progress. Do you know what I mean? But safety's such a biggie. Yeah.
I mean, how did you come about?
And back pressure, you know.
You was a loner, weren't you, for years? You was a loner for years because you've You've had more comebacks than buddy. Well, more Karate Kid. You have, I mean, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever it is. But you lived and trained on your own for a long time, Ted.
I still do. So, you know.
Are you getting any table time? Because I know you got a couple of young lads down there at times. That young Scotty, he was a training partner for a bit, weren't he?
Yeah, Scott Strong is still probably one of the most technical guys I know. He's moved out. He's doing other stuff and that. But I had two or three lads I was training with for a while there back in 2006, 2007. We were training like two or three times a week. It was, you know, it really improved my table technique. And since about 2007, 2008. Very rarely I've had much table time, just, you know, a couple of months here and there, flittered. But definitely the last 4 years, I've had no one to train with. The only table time I would get was when I went to a competition and, you know, put my elbow on the pad. That's the only time.
That's a testament, though, to your technical ability and how much you've, you know, you've progressed throughout the years in it, that you can literally take that 2, 3, 4 years off a table, go to a tournament and still be competing at that really, really high level. For all the newbies and stuff, Ted, would you tell them to pull or would you tell them to do weights? If they have the option to pull every day, would you say that's a good idea or not?
Definitely pulling over weights for sure. I wouldn't say every day, like, but yeah. Definitely, but you just can't mimic. You can't mimic it. I've tried, and I've survived, would I say, doing weights and wrestling. But I think if I was training with a club week in week out, I'd be a totally different animal. I know I would. I'd be totally different. Just get with a good club and just pull. I wouldn't worry too. You only have to look at Tom Holland to know that pulling works. It's only now that he's starting to do gym work, and you can tell as well he's starting to get even more improvements. It's crazy, but yeah, definitely pulling over weights for sure.
And how much do you think genetics has to do with it?
I don't think genetics has anything to do with it. I think it depends how great a detail you want to go into it, don't you? But you look at people like Neil, who's got the tiniest hand ever. But he had a technique that would, you know, implement that really well. It doesn't matter. I think you put the work in, you enjoy what you're doing, and you put your work in, and you've got a decent head on. Genetics don't matter. It doesn't matter at all. I got laughed at when I first started arm wrestling because I was 55 kilo, boots and jeans. Do you know what I mean? I had the big hand, but I was tiny. I'm the smallest in my family. I'm miniature. But I progressed. Everyone can progress. Everyone does. There's so many. Yeah, and you do get the freaks out there, but same again. Is it genetics or is their diet perfect? Is their lifestyle perfect? Is there, you know, there's so many different parts to everything. If you put enough time and effort into something, then you'll get better at it. You'll get good.
I just want to just jump back because a story just popped into my head. It always does when I'm talking about old school stuff. Quite a bit funny, actually. sorry, viewers, for this. But when it pops up, I've got to say it. Do you remember when we were on about 2007? Because that was a big year. Do you remember when Barry Knowles nearly lost his penis in that massage bed?
Oh, that was close.
That was horrendous, weren't it? Barry Knowles is on this massive. He's just chilling in it, right? And like we just completed day one at British Championships, haven't we? It was day one.
Yeah.
I remember Baz, if Baz had was second to Steve or not. And anyway, so I'm just getting a couple of knots out of his shoulders. We're all like, obviously, doing some gear. We actually cared about arm wrestling then. So he was actually getting knots out of his shoulders. And any road, I'd won it right, and I just won Champa Champ. I thought I'd just be a bit gay. And I thought I'd just like jump onto an oiled up Baz. And I jumped onto him, and Ben shut down, didn't it? And his knob went straight through a crack, didn't it? Like that, and he nipped his skin.
Oh, it was like, close.
Yeah. That ends for like a millimetre of taking it off. Do you remember?
Oh, yeah, man. I remember. man.
And then didn't I squeeze your penis in bed by accident?
Moving on.
these stories are for darker times, guys.
We all went to that hotel room for a bit of a party and that. And first thing Baz does, takes his jeans off. I feel comfier in my boxers. Sets the mood.
Yeah, Barry knows. I tell you what a character he is. Bloody hell, I've lost track now. Ted going back. Give us a look into Ted Wilson's weekly training. Like, explain a bit about, because people are interested, Ted. So, a little bit about the exercises you're doing, obviously, without greater detail, but more about the reps and sets, because a lot of people are unsure where to plan the routine. Some people think that doing more reps, some people think doing powerlifting style routines. Where would you go with that, Ted, in your week?
It's actually just changed for me, but back when I started, I used to do 30, 40 repetitions on everything I did, and I think that helped. Don't get me wrong, that really helped. But there's a moment in time when you have to look at serious power. You look at the Europeans training; everything's about from start to finish. A lot of pulley work. Really low reps, lots of rest. So I've just changed my training now. I've got myself a pulley system made, and I'm training nothing like, I'm not going overboard with training, but I'm just trying to keep it consistent. And I've started, because I don't have a sparring partner either, I think one the missing link in my training is the fast twitch fibers. The fast reaction times.
Yeah.
You're looking at Slough Slammers, all them boys are getting that because of the way they're training. So I've now implemented three different ways I'm training through the week. One is the explosive movements. So I train that on rotation from no weight at all on the cable and across. I also do that with my back pressure as well. From nothing, hold. Not with crazy weights, but I'll do five to six reps, no more.
Ted, just stop me though. You know when you're using your back pressure, are you coming straight back, or when you're coming back, are you dropping your wrist slightly into a pistol on that? Because when I watched one of your videos and you dropped your back pressure, it seemed to be a little drag under, but obviously popping up your pistol.
For such a long time, we're all focused on keeping that high knuckle. For me, it's never been, and in the past, I've actually lost a lot of matches because I'm coming up too high. I've just decided on going, look, I've been in it this long, let's just try something that I feel comfortable with. And now I'm starting to train with the wrist down. But not getting confused with, you could let the wrist down, but I'm making sure I've got the crank on the wrist. I still want that wrist, the wrist dominance. I really still want the power in the wrist and the forearm. I don't want to be dropped back and just everything on the back pressure. You've still got to control the movement. So everything I'm training now is with the wrist slightly down. I'm just trying to hone my movements a bit better, trying to specialise it a little bit more.
You've got that long hand, haven't you? So it's a bit easier for you to do it to your opponent. So anyone who's watching doesn't quite understand. what Ted's attempting to do is when he drags back, he's dropping his wrist even more slightly while pulling upwards, and he's trying to force the little fingers into the actual lower down the wrist one. So the more he can get more purchase through the hand and wrist, which gives him also a full hand top roll, so he's in full complete control of the hand, not like one of the ones where you see someone in a dead wrist, because a lot of people get mistaken with that one, Ted. When you take someone's fingers, you think, I've took the wrist, but really you're only implementing maybe 40-50% of your power. You know, when you take a grip further through the arm and then you pull back and you've got them, you've actually got full hand control. So it's almost like you're half in, half out, to controlling the match from every angle.
Yeah. It's about, you know, kind of letting that wrist down, so it's as though you're giving your hand to your opponent, but at the same time I'm keeping control on the lower fingers so that I can keep the control. You're not running away as such. It used to be, you know, if you had your wrist down, then you're giving your hand. Not anymore. As long as you're strong enough, you know, you train something long enough and hard enough, you're going to get stronger in that position. Yeah. It's physics. It just will. Your body will adapt. So now I'm literally just training that. But yeah, getting back to it, I'm training the explosive movements, rotation and back pressure. And then other than that, I'm training the really heavy lifts, about 3 repetitions. Further, like after a day's rest, I'll train again and I'll do 3 repetitions of really heavy, like 80-90% of my max. But because I'm not training so much statics either, I'm trying to train so that once I've done the movement, I'm not just backwards, forwards. I'm trying to pull in, hold a couple of seconds, back off before the next repetition. So I'm trying to create that isolation, that static strength, as well as movement within it. And it's cutting training time down as well. You know, it's trying to train smart rather than, static, loads of this, loads of reps, loads of everything. Just trying to keep it as simple as possible and as specialised as possible. And then the following time through the week is mainly just going through the same motions, a lot of hook movements, that back pressure rotations again, but just easy weights, you know, 10, 20 repetitions, and that's it. That's basically the outline of my training at the moment. I've got some handles coming, though. So
keep your eyes on Ted the Elf Wilson's YouTube channel for any more of these videos, guys. It's a very informative channel. He's already got some great videos and stuff up there now, so please do us a favor when you watch this, go and check him out, subscribe, like, share his stuff. Be much appreciated. Anyone in the UK, believe me, this man's the bollocks. Supplementation, any supplements, Ted, what help you with your training?
Absolutely nothing at the moment. And I've taken a lot of stuff in the past. I've taken proteins, I've taken my creatine, and tablets among tablets. But if I was supplementing now, the only things I'd recommend is your creatine, glutamine, and a good post protein. But I don't take anything at the moment. I'm kind of doing. I've been on and off keto quite a bit. It's kind of my own kind of keto. My partner is on keto. So basically everything is just meat. It's like a mixture between keto and paleo. And if I want snacks in between or treats at night, then I will. But it's just a basis. Main thing is I try and keep my 120, 130 gram of protein in so I can keep my weight down but keep my muscle mass. I've found creatine and glutamine are great. In the past when I have trained hard, they are the two supplements that, I couldn't really do without.
Yeah, I agree with glutamine. I mean, I'm a big creatine responder. I mean, that Celtex ruined my body on multiple occasions. It makes me fat without insulin spikes. But glutamine is something that, if you look online, it doesn't really get a big raver on. People are like, well, it doesn't really work. But I think that's more to those guys who are like not doing that, not on the natural game. Like I know, yeah, when I'm taking 50 grams of glutamine a day, which obviously is a lot, but when I'm taking, you know, between 30, 50 grams, I'm healing like that.
Yeah. That's it. Definitely, you can tell.
I notice a difference. I mean, I'm like yourself. I've not touched a supplement now since September last year. I might have odd protein shake after training. But like I said, then I did my arm, and then, you know, even with all the training I was doing on table every day with bars and so on, still never took anything because I thought, well, wait, let it heal. I have got a supplement stack ready that I think I'll use, but it's just going to be usual, like beta-alanine, but it has to have that L-histidine in, because I've used beta-alanine without it, and it doesn't build the carotene the same in the body, so that the one I've used is that ON one. Well, that one I really believe in. A good creatine. Generally, I like Celtec. But what I've been started doing, I just bought my own Moderhydrate, and I use the Turgo now. So I've just been making my own. I sprinkle a vitamin C in it. I don't know why. It's just that back in the day, there was a company that's in Preston. I can't think of the name now. And they did some Ultimate Nutrition, I think it was. And they used to have a creatine tablet with vitamin C in it. And I used to take them and I felt like Superman. But yeah, I took the creatine powder just on its own and it didn't. So it's always stuck with me all them years. So even when I get creatine now, I'm like, I want them S2C vitamin C's in it. It just seems for doing the trick. But and then I'll use sort of like ribose as well. I don't know if anyone knows about that. It's like creatine sister. They work like synergistically together. So your ATP stores with ribose, once you've had that loaded in your system for about a month, what you find is that the rest time in between your sets, creatine doesn't do anything for that. Creatine's just the power output. Ribose fills the timing in between the sets. And I find, but it takes about a month to load, same as the beta-alanine. But they've all clinically, I tend to take everything what's like sort of clinically proven by the glutamine, really. And the beta-alanine was... they did a 4-week study on the creatine and the levels were something like an extra 40%. And when you've been on it for 10 weeks, the levels in your body, your carotene levels, which are the ones that give you the mind-muscle connection, and it's like a lactic acid buffer, that was like 80% up. So it makes a drastic difference to like mind-muscle. So your fast twitch muscle fibre just switching on. I love it. It's the one that gives you, in a pre-workout, that gives you the tingles. But obviously, I don't do the pre-workout stuff. But and then ashwagandha as well. I'll use that. But I've been lazy like beforehand last year. But I took some of them. Orange and white thing. I was taking them for 8 weeks, and they're a clinical study. Naturally raise your testosterone. Clinically proven again. Just about 20-some odd percent, which is nothing. But it is, again, if you're natural. I mean, if you're juicing, it's doing nothing for you. Do you know what I mean? You're not going to notice a thing. But I noticed, because you get like twitches in your dick, you know what I mean? You're like sat there and you just get like a semi for no reason, you know what I mean? So you know it's working.
Oh my God, anyways.
Yeah, well, you're getting good meat, aren't you? You're a very popular puller, Ted. But who are your favourite pullers? Could be anyone around the world. Who are your favourite pullers? It could be because you like them, it could be because you like watching them. It could be because you respect the way they are. Anything.
Someone who I've always looked up to is Taras Iverkin.
Unbelievable.
I would have thought everybody should know Taras Iverkin. I met him a few times as well. Proper, decent, down-to-earth guy. But that top roll, and I know he couldn't really finish matches that well, but just ripping people's hands open. That's, you know, like, I don't think it's that often that Brzink, you know, you know, took, you know, he was always flattened out, was Brzink. Maybe not lost his wrist, but Taras always got into a top row position. Like, just ridiculous, wasn't it?
I mean, he's beaten Devin Lloratt in a Vendetta 4-2. So he's a serious dude, isn't he? He's been three or four times champion of the world.
Yeah, yeah. The other guy who I think is just all round amazing, Ron Bath. Just, you know, same, all round nice guy, can pull anywhere, just like he's made out of bloody stone. He's just rocking me. Absolute awesome. Who others? Let me think. There's hundreds, man. There's hundreds. I'll tell you who I was thinking about today that I haven't seen for ages, but I used to really enjoy watching. It was Edimir Farocco. Do you remember him?
Oh, Italian, yeah. I remember him having a war with Brzink. That was, he made his thing in Italy 2009. I think he got second in the world, did he?
Yeah.
He was an animal.
Absolute animal. Just didn't want to go anywhere else. I just liked the power movement. That dude was a beast in the hook.
I remember his little curly tight perm. I think he was an Albanian, wasn't he? Albanian import. But he was an absolute freak. He was. I mean, I remember the supermatch. I think Barker was over one year in a supermatch in Italy, weren't he? And I think John Brzink pulled for Farocco that same year. I'm sure it was 2009.
Yeah,
and he's on John's arm like that, and Farocco's like, and John's thinking, friggin' hell. I thought you'd give me someone like Pumpty, but yeah, he was an animal, wasn't he?
He was a beast.
What about you guys at UK, Ted? Like, do you think the scene's absolutely buzzing? Who are your favourite guys on the UK scene at the moment?
How long we got? I'm trying to think.
Well, just give us a couple. You know, we don't have to like get spared out and dig down too far.
Adam Johnson.
Ooh. That's it. He's got some potential. He's been around a long time, a lot longer than people say. About 11 years now he's been around, hasn't he?
The more you talk with him as well at the events, the more you realise he really has got his head screwed on. That he's a clever lad. I think we've still got a lot of big things to see from him.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, and he does keep himself on a low low, I think. But that dude is strong. Like, yeah, ridiculous. All-rounded as well. Pretty all-rounded, I think. Maybe not the fastest at times, but it's one of them. If you talk to him, he knows. He's not going to bullshit or anything. He knows the script, and that's why I think next couple of years you'll see more and more of him, slowly.
Well, that Northern Ireland team, Ted's absolutely ridiculous at the moment, isn't it?
There's loads in there now, isn't there? Yeah. There's some good lads, man. Jason Hill, I like to watch Jason.
A lot of potential.
Yeah, I think there's still a lot to come from him yet, definitely. There's like I say, the classes are getting bigger all the time, aren't they? This last couple of years, they're just growing all the time. Good. Yeah. Can't wait till this plumbing disappears.
Well, I'm going to put you on the spot now. I'm going to put you on the spot with a few super matches. Just give me who wins, because we're near at the end of the old Ted the Elf Wilson movement, and I've got some matches in front of me, and generally I always get sent in by the same person. We're going to start off with this one, because it's been spoken about again. Neil Pickup against Stoker Bogdan, right-handed.
Oh my God! See,
now, I know you're professional enough to put your friendships to one side.
Well. Is Bogdan still pulling as well? I've not seen either of them pulling.
Neil beat Graham Tizer, I think, last tournament. Said, you know what Neil's like. He said he's not training, but he's got 50 grand gym in his back garden. He's always training. He's full of shit. and then you've got Stoiker Bogdan, who just beat Stefan Thomas. I don't know. But then Neil did Stefan Thomas 2 years ago. So, you know what? I think listen, I like winding Neil up. I'm going to start the ball rolling. And if they both have 12 weeks to train, Neil Pickup beats Stoiker Bogdan. And I don't know which pains me more to say which one would win.
Yeah, I'd probably agree with you, actually, to be fair. I think it comes to that that confidence thing again. He would just dominate it, I think, to be fair.
You think he'd dominate Stoiker?
Yeah.
Oh, that'll get up Stoker's nose when he watches this. next one on the list.
It's one of them. We're talking off like Neil's not pulled for that long, but we know what he's capable of. We do know what he's capable of. But yeah, if he had 12 weeks to train, then probably, yeah.
We'd have to be there when he weighed in, though, wouldn't we?
yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, looking out by you. Dean Bulk with 104 kilo on his scale yesterday, apparently. Sean Patterson, Kieran Morrison, right hand.
Sean Patterson, definitely. Too Barry much grunt.
Barry Knowles, Chris Waters. Right hand.
Barry Knowles. I think.
Gary Ricketts, Tom Holland, left handed.
Tom at the moment, I think. How many rounds are we talking?
Well, if we're doing PAA, it's best of seven.
Yeah, I still think Tom. Yeah.
Marvin Palmer, Carl Hutchinson.
Ooh, that's a tough one.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
I'll go for Marvin Palmer.
Why?
On the fact leverage and hand control just play a big part in that one, I think.
Yeah. I think I'd go for Marv too. If I was to pick a winner.
He's got the tools.
And he's mega strong inside as well. I mean, the battles he had with Stephen Sower inside, and Sower then at that time was about, 28 stone, and he was a monster, weren't he? So.
Yeah, I'm going Marv. He's a big lad. He's got the legs. He's got the tools.
But Carl's a beast at the moment, though.
Oh, he is. Oh, there's no doubt in that. But he's still on the baby steps, isn't he? He's technical wise, it's still early days for him. Yeah, he's got the power, but that's why I think people like Marvin will still beat him at the moment.
David Bradford, Lee Webber.
Oh, man. Right-handed, yeah.
It could be any.
I think Lee Webber.
There
you go. Yeah, statically way stronger. Just David's fast, getting really technical, but Lee Webber's just like a wall, isn't he? I think statically he's just too strong. Yeah.
Connor Sale and Tom Allerton.
Tom, I think. Be hell of a war, but Tom. Yeah.
Have a big Tom. Right, Ted, we're coming to the final parts. And this is all about you, okay? You've got maybe three answers. You win, they win, or you kick their ass, okay? them are your three answers, okay? Let's see if Ted's got this confidence. All right. Tom Mitchell.
I win.
Dave Savory.
I win.
Chris Waters.
I win.
Anil.
I win.
Jerome Bloom.
I win.
Barry Knowles.
Kick his ass.
Oh, and Urban Armstrong.
The kick his ass.
Ted, the Elf Wilson, thank you so much for joining me in Mighty's Corner. It's been an absolute pleasure, bud. You've had an amazing career. Mate. Long may it continue. Please get to Ted the Elf Wilson on YouTube. Give it a little plug, Ted, before we go.
Yeah, Ted the Elf Wilson. Everything from athlete insight, talking with other wrestlers, and going back to the basics, helping the beginners, anybody getting into the sport. Yeah, loads of tips, hints, and help, training-wise. You name it, check it out.
Yeah, guys, make sure you like, share, subscribe, if you've not already done so, on both channels. It means a lot. We're really trying to push the UK and Ireland and British arm wrestling to the absolute max. Neil is off out doing his stuff, doing a fantastic job. He's putting the UK on the map elsewhere. Mike, myself and Ted are looking at building the UK. Please jump on also to the other guys, the Sussex YouTube channel, fantastic stuff. And of course, London Arm Wrestling, they have some amazing stuff as well. If I've missed you, please forgive me, but we've got clubs all over the country. We've got fantastic coaches and teachers all over the country. You can contact myself, or you can contact Ted, or you can contact anybody. The more arm wrestlers, the better. Thank you so much, guys, for keep supporting. And Ted, take care, and I'll see you in a bit.
Cheers, bud. You too. Thank you. Bye.